Welcome to the DC Marvel Battlecast, where we discuss all things DC and Marvel related, and we debate who would win in versus battle matchups. I'm Johnny DC.
And I'm his twin brother, Marvelous Joe.
The song at the beginning was Purple Lamborghini by Skrillex and Rick Ross from the Suicide Squad album, which is available on iTunes, Spotify, or wherever you buy or stream music.
And if you didn't know, I was doing the robot during the intro.
And I was doing the rolling the dice.
You should...
The
one move that you have?
The Seth Rogen. Well, the one move that Seth Rogen has.
Remember, listeners, that you can subscribe to us on iTunes or SoundCloud or YouTube. Just go ahead and do a search for DC Marvel Battlecast and you can find us there.
Yeah.
Or you can find us on Twitter at DC Marvel Battle. That's our Twitter handle. Or email us at DCMarvelBattlecast@gmail.com. Go ahead and send us your thoughts on
anything, our episodes. Really. We're lonely.
Yeah.
Talk to us.
We were thinking about creating a letter section. So if you guys have any questions, like if you want to get our opinions or if you have an opinion of your own that you'd like to share on the podcast, go ahead and let us know and we'll talk about it. As long as it's Marvel DC related. If you have advice like with a girlfriend or something like that.
I could totally still help you with that.
Yeah, we can still help you. Just we won't talk about it on the podcast. So.
Yeah, yeah. So real quick, back to the Purple Lamborghini song.
Yeah.
Music video came out the same day as Suicide Squad.
Yeah, yeah. Because I was waiting for it. I didn't know if they were going to release it.
I heard it was going to be released like a long time ago, like August 1st or something like that.
Yeah. So it looks like it was used as more of a promotional tool to try to get people to look at the Joker and kind of get excited for the film.
There was more Joker in the music video than there was in the movie.
Yeah, and that's...
Which is one of the gripes I have with the movie, which is one of the things we'll be talking about once we get to our review of Suicide Squad later on in the podcast.
Right. Yep. But first, we're going to go over the news.
Yeah.
So what will we be talking about, Johnny DC?
So we're going to start off with the Suicide Squad box office recap. We're going to go into some casting news regarding Spider-Man, some potential villain news for Aquaman, and a few other bits in the movie realm. Then we switch over to TV. We're going to go over the new Luke Cage trailer and some Arrowverse DC TV news. As well as some Doctor Strange photos.
Yep.
Talk about that. It's pretty cool.
Sounds like a good episode. Let's go ahead and get into it.
Cool. So, Suicide Squad box office recap.
I heard it. I had a feeling it was going to be a big drop. And I think, in reality, it wasn't quite as big of a drop as I thought it was going to be. I thought we were going to be seeing a drop of almost 80% drop from the opening weekend to this weekend. But it's actually less than that, yeah?
It was, domestically, it was 67.3.
Yeah. Most movies see about a drop of around 60. So, I mean, this is like 50 to 60. So this is still steep, but it's not quite as bad as some people were.
I still think BVS still has the record for that. I think it was like 71. So it was, that's a guess. I think I remember being 71.
It was somewhere around there.
Yeah. So this is close. But, I mean, it's still... Like BVS's second week, it still took the number one spot of the week.
Right.
Its biggest competition was Sausage Party.
Which was a great movie.
I haven't seen it yet. I want to see it. But, it's still doing well. I think this studio is much happier with the results of Suicide Squad than BVS. And also just because, I mean, like on Rotten Tomatoes, it has a 27% along with BVS. But... The audience reaction is better. Like, it has a B cinema score. No, B plus cinema score.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
And BVS got a B.
A B, yeah.
So, that's like a strong indicator as to, like, how much it'll make down the road.
Yeah.
So, Suicide Squad should have a higher, I think they call it a multiplier, in terms of, like, how much... it'll continue to make in the long run.
Do you still think... I think you said that you thought it was going to make in the 700 millions of dollars.
Did I?
Yeah. I guess was like 680, 640, something around there.
I think it'll be more than 650.
Yeah.
Because it's already like approaching 500 million.
Okay.
Like this next week, it should cross that mark. Okay. So I think that's a really strong, safe bet.
Do you think it'll make as much as Guardians of the Galaxy?
How much did that make?
That was like 770, I want to say.
That's a good question. Maybe not in theaters.
No.
But, I mean, they don't really... I wish they tracked like DVD sales and stuff like that. But that's hard to do with like streaming and everything.
Right. I don't think it'll make as. I don't think it'll get to 770. I think in the end, Guardians of the Galaxy will still have made more in theaters, mainly due to word of mouth. I don't think that the word of mouth of this movie is going to be as strong. I do have to give it kudos for getting the biggest opening in August of all time.
Yeah, it set a few records.
And no. it didn't just set the record, it freaking demolished it.
Yeah. So what was Guardians of the Galaxy?
High 90s.
And this was 130?
135.
Yeah, which is like pretty accurate to what people were projecting. I mean, there was like a week before where they're like, it's going to make 160. But then like it went back down to 130. Yeah. So.
But to beat the previous record by 40 million is a lot. Yeah. It's not like just 5 or 10 million. It's 40, which is pretty impressive. So,
the marketing was really good for the film. The marketing was great.
Yeah. So despite what you may think of the film, you definitely have to give kudos to the marketing because they definitely did their jobs. They earned their paychecks. And
apparently they edited the film too. So
I saw a new poster for Suicide Squad when I went to go see Sausage Party. And I don't know if you saw it, but it was like a bowl of cereal, like the entire... Yeah. Have you seen that?
Yeah, the cereal one.
That was a cool poster.
That was a cool poster.
It was like a bowl of cereal and like the marshmallows were like the Suicide Squad
sugar skulls
characters. Skulls and like katana swords and stuff. And I was like, oh, that's a brilliant. If only the movie was as good as the marketing. I don't know if that's a spoiler for a review.
No.
But if you want to know what that is, just keep listening.
Yeah. All right. So yeah, there's that.
Yeah.
And we'll get into like a lot more Suicide Squad news in addition to the review later on in the podcast because there are a few other news items to drop. But
yep.
They all kind of relate to the film.
Right.
So
the next bit of news we have, the Tinkerer is confirmed to be a character in the Spider-Man Homecoming film. I think we all knew that. That was heavily rumored.
Yeah.
But we didn't know who would be playing the Tinkerer. And it's been confirmed this past week that the actor will be Michael Chernus, I think.
Who the hell is that?
I swear I've seen him in a few commercials, but I know him primarily from Orange is the New Black. He plays the main character's kind of hippie brother.
Oh, really?
Yeah. He's funny. He seems like a comedic actor. I could totally see him as kind of, he's really sarcastic. In that show, in Orange is the New Black, so I could see him as kind of like this smart, sarcastic kind of, provider of tech for Spider-Man's villains, basically.
I'm kind of disappointed that, like, all of the previous, like, casting announcements we've received, like, there are bigger names than Michael Chernus.
Mm-hmm.
In this cast,
yeah,
and like I'm afraid they're all gonna just be like high school teachers, just like cameos. I don't know.
It's possible. It's possible. Well, we don't
like
know.
Like Donald yet. Glover. Who is he?
I really want to know who he is. He's like the biggest question mark for me.
Yeah.
The others, I'm just assuming, you know, they'll play some part or something. It would be like blow my mind if he ends up playing like J. Jonah Jameson or something crazy like that.
Donald Glover?
I don't think he will because I think my theory is still that what's his face is going to be
Robbie
Robertson. What was the comedian's name?
I remember Hannibal Buress.
Yeah, we disagreed on how you pronounce it.
Buress.
Hannibal Buress.
Yeah.
I think is going to be Robbie Robertson, but
that makes sense.
I still don't know who Donald Glover could possibly be playing.
I guess are you excited by this news? Are you excited about this casting?
Michael
Trinus?
I'm not excited by the casting. I think it's cool to see that the Tinkerer has been confirmed because he...
Yeah. Yeah, and the Vulture hasn't even been confirmed. I mean,
right?
Well, actually, it has with the
with the concept
with Comic-Con with the concept that's art.
True.
Yeah,
that's true. But prior to that, it wasn't fully confirmed. But
I heard a rumor too that kind of scares me.
What?
That the Tinkerer is providing tech for the Vulture, which I figured, but also the Shocker, which
I heard that too.
The Shocker is like my least favorite Spider-Man villain.
He's everybody's least favorite Spider-Man villain. That's not true. I like the Shocker in that he's useful as kind of like a mid-tier kind of Spider-Man villain. Like, he's more low-level in terms of his popularity and abilities and everything like that than other villains. So I don't think, like, if you shortchange him and only make him, like a secondary villain that only gets, you know, so much screen time... I don't think anybody will be disappointed because nobody's really excited by the Shocker.
So is he gonna be like the Rhino from Amazing Spider-Man 2?
Yeah, kind of like that, but like as a character and an aesthetic, I think the Rhino is a better character than Shocker. Shocker just shoots shockwaves and everything, so you definitely can't make him the primary villain of a film. But if you need some kind of like something above a Rent-A-Thug, Shocker is the way to go.
He's also kind of like generic power kind of guy that he just like shoots like.
Shockwaves.
Yeah. But, like, I almost feel like that's more powerful than the Vulture. It's like that the Vulture and the Shocker went toe-to-toe. The Shocker is going to win.
That's probably true.
It's just a more powerful generic it may be, but more powerful power, superpower
set. Yeah, that's what I'm going to see. I wonder if they're going to, increase the Vulture's abilities or anything like that, is make him more powerful than he normally is. Because you're right. I think the Shocker could beat the Vulture in a fight. So it'll be... I don't know. We'll see. We'll see what happens. We don't know what's happening.
Yeah.
But I'll be okay if the Shocker's in this movie, in Spider-Man Homecoming, because he's not going to get his own film. Yeah. So...
I was excited. I feel like... again, this cast seems like it's going to be so huge. I was excited for previous ones. This one doesn't excite me. I would have to agree, though, that...
casting?
Yeah, this casting, the Michael Trance casting. I would have to agree that I'm glad that Tinker was finally confirmed.
Yeah, and he might play, roles in multiple movies and everything like that, I think.
Oh, yeah, and, like, the extended Marvel universe.
Yeah, and the extended Marvel universe.
That would make sense.
All right.
As for DC villains, Black Manta has been reported to be the villain for Aquaman, which is also slightly... Okay, I really like Black Manta. But this news is kind of disappointing to me.
Okay. I was hoping it would be Ocean Master.
Marvelous Joe and I we actually wrote an Aquaman script. Like, what was it?
Way back
in the
day.
How long ago was it?
Must be almost 10 years now.
Yeah. But in that script, we had Ocean Master as the villain. In an origin story for Aquaman, I think Ocean Master makes the most sense.
Because Ocean Master is Orin's half-brother.
Half-brother, yeah. Right. And they're both kind of like vying for the throne. So in a film where I don't think that Aquaman is in like the current state of the DC cinematic or extended universe, DC films universe, I don't think Aquaman's the king yet. And I think in the film is when he sort of like takes up that mantle.
Mm-hmm.
So you almost need... Ocean Master, his brother Orm, in that film.
Didn't we hear a rumor that it's possible that Ocean Master might be in the Justice League movie? Or was that just speculation on who, what's his face might be playing? The guy who played Green Goblin.
Oh, Willem Dafoe.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't remember that at all.
Oh, no? Okay. No. I might have just dreamt that.
Honestly,
it may have just been a dream that I had that I'm speculating on right now.
If I had, like, my perfect casting choice for Ocean Master, it would be... he just took up a role in the Thor movie. He was Judge Dredd. Why can't I remember his
Carl
name?
Urban?
Carl Urban. Because I think he looks similar to Jason Momoa. I thought that was perfect. I think. Yes, I do.
They don't look anything alike, man.
No, they have like bushy eyebrows and like mean stares. I don't know.
I guess they could share a father, maybe, but their mothers would look wildly different.
I think that would be fitting with the story.
Okay.
But anyway, Ocean Master may not be in this film. He may be, but...
Back to Black Manta.
back to Black Manta. Who do you think would be a good Black Manta?
Well, they've been some fan castings. I think... who put their name in the ring? Yeah, I can't remember. I'm horrible with names today. Spawn, the guy who played Spawn.
I should know his name. He's been in quite a few DC projects.
Yeah, he was in The Dark Knight.
Michael J. White.
Michael J. White. Is that right?
Is that his name?
Yeah, Michael J. Yeah, J. A. I. White. Michael J. White. Yeah.
Yeah. And there was another guy from The Wire. I'm not familiar with him, though.
I don't.
I
never saw The Wire.
Yeah, me neither.
I know.
I know.
I need to see it.
I know. We know.
Actually, I first saw the first two episodes, but I digress. I think Michael J. White would make a fantastic Black Manta.
Yeah. I feel like he needs a good role because the guy's talented.
He is talented.
He's like a really good
martial
artist.
And he was kind of given like the short straw with Spawn. Yeah.
He would be a good Blade, I think.
He would be a good Blade, actually. Yeah. If Wesley Snipes never came back to the role, which he's probably too old to do now.
Yeah. I don't know. But I love Black Manta as a character. He's a really good villain. So yeah.
What does he do exactly? Black Manta. I know he shoots red beams from his eyes.
Yeah.
He's also force beams, or are they heat beams? What are they? What are they?
I think they're heat.
Okay.
Yeah. He's just really freaking brutal. Superpower wise.
So his superpower is that he's really brutal?
He's like the Joker. I mean, he's like Aquaman's Joker. It's like Aquaman, or Joker doesn't have powers.
Right.
When you have like extreme, he's like really good planning. Who was it this time? Who was it this time?
That's me.
Sorry, guys. Your phones didn't go off. It was Marvelous Joe being a dick. What was I saying? Oh, superpowers. He plans stuff out really well. And he has really high-tech equipment for fighting in the water and stuff.
Okay. But he wears, like, a scuba suit, right?
Yeah.
He's just a man. He's not an Atlantean.
Yeah, he's just a man. There was a period in the comics where he was, like, part amphibian because he sold his soul to Nero, like the DC's devil.
Oh, really?
But yeah, I think they did away with that.
What is his goal? What is his motivation in the comics? Does Black Manta want to rule Atlantis, or what is?
No, he wants to kill Aquaman because Aquaman killed his father accidentally.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So revenge.
Yeah.
Interesting.
It's interesting because like that's usually like the superhero origin where your parents die and you kind of like take up this cause to like fight injustice. Well, Black Manta to just straight up murder the Aquaman.
That's cold-blooded.
Yeah.
All right. So, moving on to Marvel Universe news. We have some new photos from the Doctor Strange film that they put out. I think there are about 4 new photos. Some of them were from Entertainment Weekly that show us more imagery regarding like the
of exactly how, what I want to see
how they use their powers
like
and stuff.
Magical like energy like
sigils and, energy and stuff and so you can view them online. There's one photo of like it's like that Tesseract city kind of thing, all trippy and cool, but one of the images shows him using the Eye of Agamotto.
Yeah.
And if you haven't seen this film or this photo, you can go ahead and Google image search it. But Benedict Cumberbatch, he's using a green sigil, and the Eye of Agamotto is glowing green, and which has led many people to speculate that this may be the time gem, or the time stone.
Which, based on your theory that you explained in the past. In the last podcast about how magic is used, I think totally fits.
Yeah, we'll see.
I really liked that theory. I hope that's how it works.
Yeah. Like accessing, like magic is just accessing alternate realities.
Yeah. Kinda. Wait, can you explain the Eye of Agamotto?
So the Eye of Agamotto is a magical relic that Doctor Strange uses, and it has a variety of functions. It's kind of a MacGuffin, but he can like see through illusions. He can see through space and time, and do just a lot of different effects with it. If his Eye of Agamotto is like a time gem that allows him to kind of like see through time and things like that, then it would make sense. I think.
Yeah.
And the fact that it's glowing green, which none of the other stones have done yet, because we've had the space gem, the space stone, which glows blue, the reality gem, which glows red, the mind gem, which glows yellow, the power gem, which glows purple. So we still need green and orange. And it's been rumored that the time gem would show up in Doctor Strange, and that the soul gem, which I'm guessing is the orange one, would show up in Thor Ragnarok.
And if none of this makes sense, this is all leading up to the Infinity Gauntlet storyline.
Yes, so eventually all the gems will be acquired by Thanos.
Spoiler. Not spoiler.
Not really a spoiler. Who is the purple, powerful space alien guy who was behind Loki's invasion in the first Avengers movie.
Yeah.
And he also showed up in Guardians of the Galaxy, so he acquires these gems, and that's what creates the Infinity War.
Yeah,
because he basically becomes omnipotent by acquiring all these gems. I think that the fan theory that's out there, that in this image that we see the time gem glowing inside of the Eye of Agamotto, I think it fits.
And I also like the fact that like. It also means that by the time we reach the Infinity War in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, Doctor Strange may be depowered a little bit. So he won't be, like, omnipotent, you know?
I'm thinking that... So
it, because obviously you would have to take the Eye of Agamotto away from him to get that.
Right, yeah, that it's Thanos' destiny to acquire all the gems. So it's possible that Doctor Strange doesn't derive all of his power from the Eye of Agamotto.
Right.
It is a powerful artifact that he uses, but it's not this like the source of his power or anything. So even if he were to lose the Eye of Agamotto, he would still be a powerful sorcerer.
Yeah, but depowered. And a little, I guess by depowered, I don't mean like completely like useless. Stripped of power. I just mean like toned down
a little bit. Possibly. I don't know. We'll see how it's used in the movie. I'm interested in, because, you know, it might turn out that, you know, this item accounts for a lot of what happens in the movie and a lot of the things that he's able to do. So we'll see exactly how that turns out, I guess.
Yeah.
But it's a cool image. If you haven't seen it, I guess go ahead and do an image search for Eye of Agamotto, Doctor Strange movie. So,
yeah. Back to DC news. Small-ish news, but I was happy when I heard it. The Shazam film, the one that The Rock, Dwayne Johnson, has been confirmed to play the villain in, Black Adam. The Shazam film has been confirmed to be part of the DC Extended Universe. Now, we weren't sure this was going to happen because it's not being produced by Warner Brothers. It's being produced by their subsidiary,
New Line. Yeah. Is that still the case?
Yeah.
Do we know?
Yeah.
Okay.
Still the case. And also The Rock's like production company, I forget the name of it. But anyway, it's not under the Warner, it is under the Warner Brothers umbrella ultimately, but it'll be the only film that won't be produced by that.
It'll studio. Be the only New Line film.
Yeah. Yeah. So the fact that it's going to be, you know, we'll have Shazam along with the other DC characters, the Justice League characters like Superman and Batman and Wonder Woman, super cool, because I'm still waiting for the day when they adapt Kingdom Come. That's ultimately why I feel like all DC stories sort of lead into.
I like Shazam as a character, and at this point I think The Rock has enough star power. I remember when he was first rumored to be attached to this project was years ago, and he looks exactly like Black Adam, so you know that's what a lot of people wanted. But I think at this point his star has risen so high that I think it would be more profitable for the studio to make him Shazam. And I think that would be awesome. I think it would add a little bit of diversity to the Justice League mix and everything like that.
Yeah.
Although, I'm pretty sure Aquaman is Samoan as well, isn't he?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You have two Samoans. But
the actor who plays him, Jason Momoa.
Do you think they should change The Rock's role from Black Adam to Shazam?
You could honestly, he could be both. Because like the whole idea behind Shazam is that
that's true.
When you speak the word Shazam, you become this powerful figure. So, I wouldn't really care for it. I think he would make a better like, because Black Adam is like this really cool like dictator, almost Doctor Doom kind of figure in the DC comics.
But I think The Rock has enough charisma,
to pull off
this. It's basically a kid who turns into an adult superhero.
Yeah. And that's like really the appeal is like seeing this like huge guy with all these powers just, you know, like also have the mind of a kid. Really, it's like he is a kid.
Yeah. It's like big meets Superman.
Yeah. Man of Steel. Yeah, exactly.
So,
I haven't seen that new film with The Rock and Kevin Hart.
Oh, Central Intelligence?
Yeah.
I saw it.
But I saw the trailers and he's
fantastic. He looked like he
was funny. Yeah. He's good in any role. He's just a good actor.
Yeah, he is.
I guess that could work. And you know,
maybe honestly, we could have The Rock be Shazam and Vin Diesel be Black Adam.
Oh gosh. The Rock makes Vin Diesel look like a chump, like a scrawny chump.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know.
I think I'd be interested in seeing him play both. I think that might be a good project for him.
Yeah.
So, and also, it may be even cooler since it's going to be part of the DC Films universe to have The Rock show up as Shazam in, like, Justice League Part 2, or the sequel, or something like that.
Yeah.
And, like, you know, fight along Batman and Superman and stuff. Man, that would be amazing. That would
be really cool. And again, like I said, Kingdom Come, just because Shazam plays such a huge role in that, he's, like, one of the four main, or I guess there's six key players in that. Five or six. Anyway, he's one of them. So, yeah. Good news. On the DC front, it was officially announced that Man of Steel 2, the next Superman movie is in active development at Warner Brothers.
That's great news.
Super great news. Super happy to hear that, because I wasn't sure, like, they were ever going to make, like, another Superman movie, or if it was just going to be continuous.
And they really, they kind of need to, in my opinion, they kind of do need to do a little damage control as far as the character is concerned. I don't know, we know that he's not going to get as much screen time as others in the new Justice League movie. Because he won't show up right away. Mm-hmm. And I think it's important to kind of refocus back to him, because he is DC's most important character, and they still have to get him right. I think they still need to do the character justice and portray him in a way that hoping to see him.
I guess you could say he's DC's most important character. Batman is probably the most popular, but yeah, since Superman was the first superhero, yeah, I'd probably agree. I definitely think that Warner Brothers is keen on making this next one, like, the most hopeful, like, brightest Superman film to ever be made.
If we get to see him, like, a kind of a transformed, more optimistic character coming out of death, you know, in the Justice League movie, and then just carry that forward into, like, an enjoyable Superman film, I think that's the best way to go. I think they'll make more money doing it, honestly.
Yeah. I mean, I liked Man of Steel. I really liked the sci-fi angle on Superman, making it like a first contact kind of story.
Yeah, there were some cool character choices in terms of his story and stuff.
But now that that's been established, you could kind of get more into, just more into what makes Superman, like, the greatest superhero and greatest, like, sort of, like, representation of
what... Get to the appeal of the character, which is not the sci-fi stuff.
True.
The sci-fi stuff is cool and everything, but it's not, I wouldn't say it gets to the appeal of the character, because Superman has never really been...
It's the most grounded, like, approach to the character, which, based off the Dark Knight and Christopher Nolan's, like, grounded approach to Batman, and, you know, they're trying to spin off Man of Steel, the sci-fi approach, definitely was the most accessible, mm-hmm. but now... We've accessed him.
And I was also nervous that they wouldn't get to a Man of Steel sequel. I was kind of like, the pessimistic side of me was thinking that we'd get a new, you know, Ben Affleck Batman trilogy before we ever get another, you know,
Superman film.
So, I think you got to keep those films going. I think we need Wonder Woman sequels, and you know, this is all assuming that there will still be, they don't screw it up royally as they've been doing, and we still have a DC Films universe in the next few years.
I don't think that's going to happen.
No.
No, I think just because of what Marvel is doing, and because DC Warner Brothers has these characters because they own DC Comics, mm-hmm. I think they'll always just continue to sort of adapt those characters and not really stop making those films. As long as Marvel films are making money, DC will continue to pump out DC films, I think.
That's probably true. All right. All right. So moving back to the Marvel side of things and TV news.
Yeah.
We got a new Luke Cage trailer this past week, which I was not expecting. I thought we would only be having the teaser, that really cool Comic-Con teaser, for, you know, the next few months.
It was really quick, yeah. When does Luke Cage
come out? It does come out at the end of September, though. The end of next month.
That makes sense.
I guess it does make sense to have an official new trailer, full-length trailer.
I liked it. I didn't like it as much as the teaser.
Well, the teaser was just really quick and punchy and everything, and it was very hip-hoppy. This one wasn't quite as hip-hoppy. It was more soulful, and it gave off a much different vibe from the teaser, I think. But just as good. I mean, I liked it just as much. We got to see Luke Cage, the whole Seagate prison. Sorry, I accidentally hit play on that. The whole Seagate prison experiment, and the story of Luke Cage is that he was framed, went to prison, and they experimented on him, and there was this. He volunteered for the experiment, I think, and there was a for his freedom, and there was a racist prison guard who messed with the controls, and it accidentally, like, gave him too much of I forgot. What it was. It was some kind of chemical mixture, but it made him impervious, and he was able to escape.
I have to say, it was really cool to see him, like, with, like, the Power Man, like, bracelets and
tiara. Yeah, that's what I was getting to. Yeah, so as he steps out of the experiment and everything, he has the bracelets and the tiara, which is a nice callback. I think I'm the consensus sure is that we don't want to see him wearing that.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure he'll just, like, wear that as he's, like, breaking out of prison or whatever.
Yeah, as a mush.
Does he do that? Does he break out of prison?
Yes, he does. Yeah, he
so, breaks yeah, out of prison. Yeah, and then we'll probably never see it again.
Yeah.
That's my guess.
I still have yet to see him in a yellow shirt, but they might be saving that.
Maybe it's an orange shirt if he's getting out of, I don't know, prison, maybe. I don't know.
No, it has to be, like, a tight yellow t-shirt.
He has, like, in the inside of his, like, jacket that he's wearing, like, it's, like, yellow. So there's kind of
that. Oh, that's true. I think that this film... So Luke Cage started out in the 1970s as a response to the kind of blaxploitation era that was happening in film and in television, like with Shaft and things like that. And so that was Marvel's response. He was the first, you know, African-American to have his own solo series.
I thought that was Black Panther.
African-American character. African-American. Black Panther was African.
Oh.
So he was the first African-American to have his own solo series. And so the impression that I got from this trailer was that, so the blaxploitation is no longer a thing. Like, they don't make that genre of film anymore, but
unless you're Quentin Tarantino,
there is still black cinema out there. Like, and one of the examples that this trailer reminded me of was, like, it felt very barbershop. It felt very, like BET kind of style movie, which I think is fantastic. And the fact that, like, you know, he was having that conversation with, I don't know if that was one of his relatives. I don't think it was his dad or anything, but it might be just his friend who is the barber and everything. And they're in Harlem and, you know, they're hanging out and he's saving Harlem. And I think that's fantastic. I think it's a nice, it's just another genre to present these superhero stories in, you know, to prevent genre fatigue.
Mm-hmm.
And if anybody deserves, like, a BET style type drama action TV it's Luke Cage. Yeah, he's fantastic. Yeah. He very much represents in my mind the epitome of American black culture, I guess.
I just love that, like, just these trailers, I just get so giddy when you see that, like, that power fantasy, that Superman complex where he's just walking around and he could just do whatever he wants to those guys.
Mm-hmm.
And he, you know, he just remains immune to anything they attempt on him.
Mm-hmm.
Which you think would be, like, a bad thing because you want your character to face trials and challenges. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, it seems like he still will because of just his environment, but, like, his trials and challenges don't come from, like, the guys, because he's just, like, lifting them up and throwing them, and it's like, I want to be Luke Cage. That is the coolest thing ever.
Oh yeah, definitely. It's definitely a whole, like, power again, fantasy. It's not just a power fantasy. It's like he got his original name, Power Man, in relation to, it was some kind of quote, if I remember this correctly. They asked him how he escaped or something. He was like, it's like a black power. It's Black Power Man or something like that.
Oh, really?
Like, oh, yeah. So that's how he got his nickname, which he has since discarded. He's not called Power Man anymore. Much less Black Power Man.
Yeah.
But he's not called Power Man anymore. He just goes by Luke Cage. But I wonder if they will call him Power Man at any point in the
TV. If they show. Do it, it's probably just gonna be an Easter egg.
Easter egg thing. Yeah.
He'll probably just dismiss it and be like, "What?
Do you think they'll show any part of the Heroes for Hire story? Because it looks like he's out there and he's trying to be hero and he's trying to protect these companies who are being extorted by gangs or mafia.
Who is the villain?
I actually don't know that. I'll have to look that up later. I don't know. I don't want to look it up right now.
Yeah.
But
anyway, we're talking
basically
about
basically the villains are gangs and mafia, it looks like.
Uh-huh.
So yeah, he's going out there and he's trying to be a hero and he's trying to protect these people, but I wonder if we'll ever get the aspect where he, you know, does it for money. Which you know, that's always been kind of like a controversial aspect of the character. Like, being a hero for hire is controversial. And I don't know if that's something that you want to portray in the films or if you want to portray that controversy, because it certainly exists, and I don't think the character has ever shied away from it or anything. But it would be an interesting dynamic to explore.
Wasn't it him and Iron Fist? They were the heroes for hire?
Yeah, him and Iron Fist. Originally, he was just the hero for hire, though.
Uh-huh.
And then Iron Fist joined, and they were the heroes for hire.
Hmm. That's a good question. I wouldn't be surprised if, like, like the whole barbershop kind of scene, like someone like recommends that to him.
Yeah. Or maybe somebody just pays him kind of for services, like he's not asking for it and they just do it. And then he you know, he gets the idea or something like that.
That'd be cool.
Maybe it's more of like a tip jar thing as opposed to like, you know, a service fee kind of thing. Because I don't think you want to be, you know, like charging these Harlem residents for his services, you know.
Yeah, it's not like Tony, you know, Tony Stark or any of the other Avengers or anyone else does that. Daredevil doesn't do that.
Right. Know? Exactly. So, yeah, it would be kind of.
That is controversial.
Selfish.
Interesting.
But so Rosario Dawson. What did Darson. I say? Darson?
Darson.
Dawson. Rosario Dawson makes a few appearances in the trailer. So it looks like she might play somewhat of a role in the show. I don't know if did I see
is she supplanting? A possible
romantic entanglement?
Yeah, that's what I was. That's what I was wondering. Is she supplanting Jessica Jones as like, the romantic interest?
There's a shot where they embrace, but I don't. I would be surprised if they get together romantically because we all know that eventually he's going to get back with Jessica Jones,
knock her up.
Yeah. So, and Rosario Dawson also plays. You know, she played a small role in the Jessica Jones TV show. So. I don't know. It's all connected. And
in Daredevil.
I think it would be surprising. I don't think they would want to go that kind of like love triangle route. Yeah, because Daredevil and Rosario Dawson had
a thing
in that show. So, I don't know. Maybe she's the one that forms the Defenders together.
I wonder. Like, yeah, that's the connecting thread, right?
Yeah. You don't know. So, yeah, if you haven't seen the Luke Cage trailer, go ahead and check it out. It's I think a little bit not quite as good as the teaser, but it definitely shows much more of the show. So in that essence, it makes me more excited for the show.
I definitely want to see it. Gosh, I still need to see Jessica Jones.
Yeah, go watch Jessica Jones. Man, you say that every podcast.
Like I was going to, then like I got caught up in Stranger Things and.
Oh, did you finish watching that?
Yeah, that was cool. But yeah, maybe the next thing I'll watch is Jessica Jones.
Yeah, you should do that.
Until the next podcast, where I'm like, man, I need to watch Jessica Jones.
Okay.
So on the DC side for television, Sarah Gray has been cast as Stargirl in Legends of Tomorrow. She's going to be part of the JSA. And Stargirl is a creation of Geoff Johns.
Yeah, based off his sister, right?
Is it?
Yeah. His sister died of cancer,
right.
I believe.
That's right.
And so he kind of, in honor of her, he wrote her in as a superhero character in the JSA comics.
That's right. Yeah, so, and I know he's heavily involved with the television Arrowverse. So,
oh, is he?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm not surprised that she's in there at all. He kind of tends to, like, put her in a lot of different things. Like, he put her in, what was it? Justice League of America. Mm-hmm. I think he wrote that. Oh, crap. Did he write that? He may not have. Anyway, not surprised. Glad to see that the character's in the show, though.
Yeah. Well, now, will she have her, like, star shooting powers, or will she have the star rod?
It's a good question, because the star rod is sort of like a legacy thing, which Legends of Tomorrow is kind of, like, tailor-made for, in a way, uh-huh. because of time travel.
Yeah.
But we'll see. There's a lot of other cool characters that are going to be the JSA, like Hourman, like Commander Steel.
I don't know who Commander Steel is.
Commander Steel?
Yeah.
I think it was a Golden Age. I think it must have been if it was JSA. No, I guess not.
He's
anyway.
A Golden Age JSA member?
I think so. Or Silver Age. I forget. Anyway, he's just a guy with, like, metal skin, I believe. But then, like, his, like, nephew or something like that, a relative of his, becomes Citizen Steel later on. Just sort of like another legacy character.
Mm-hmm.
But I think they have both Citizen Steel and Commander Steel in the Legends of Tomorrow. I forget who's playing them. The real news here was that Stargirl's in the show. And then on the Arrow side, really big casting news, I think. Dolph Lundgren is cast as... Kovar, a character named Kovar.
Who's Kovar?
That's a good question. I mean, if there is a Russian superhero in the DC comics universe, his last name is Kovar. Crap, what is his first name?
Oh, is he
name?
Playing the same role that he did in Rocky IV?
Maybe. No, I doubt it. He's just a Russian superhero who's like super strong, super fast, and can shoot like plasma or like energy.
Uh-huh.
Kind of like a generic kind of power set, but it's kind of, again, it's, I love these Arrowverse TV shows because you see so many DC characters. Like, and I'm pretty sure it's going to be, like, all in the flashbacks. He probably has a primary role in the flashbacks where he, like, probably trains the Green Arrow, Oliver Queen. Hmm. So that's really cool to see such, like, a higher-ish profile actor being cast as this character. A Russian superhero character.
Yeah, okay.
It's Dolph Lundgren.
Yeah.
Come on.
I guess.
He was He-Man.
He was cool in... I'm trying to think of what he was cool in. I didn't like his Punisher movie. I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
I guess he's right. an '80s icon. He's an '80s staple.
So. Yeah, for sure. I just wonder if he's going to have, like, superpowers in the show. Honestly, I don't know. You probably won't.
We'll see.
I don't know.
I don't know if you're going to watch the show, even.
That piques my interest. Because, like, this is the last show. This is the last season that wraps up his entire flashback story. Because he was on the island for 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
And in this section of the story, you know, he travels to Russia to do training. And then eventually he has to make his way back to the island. Anyway, it wraps that up. So, I don't know.
All right.
Yeah. And then, what else is... Okay. This was news that should have been on the last podcast, but, like, we're so caught up in all the other news from Comic-Con. Tyler Hoechlin.
Is that how we're pronouncing it now?
Hoechlin?
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 I still haven't figured out the correct pronunciation.
Hoechlin. I'm going to say Hoechlin. has been cast as Superman on the Supergirl TV show. Which is... What? I don't understand how you can have a character as big, you know, high profile as Superman on the TV show, yet you can't have characters like Amanda Waller or Black Canary because of the whole, like, you know, they're saying you can't have the same characters in the TV universe and the movie universe. But yet you have a Flash TV show. Gosh.
It's dumb. It's inconsistent and dumb. Like, they should be able to, if it's a true multiverse, they should be able to have, you know, be able to share their characters and everything.
Well, they get Batman in the Arrow show, man.
Not share actors, awesome. But definitely share characters.
Yeah, characters.
So, what did you think of Hoechlin in the Superman suit?
Hoechlin.
I think the first promo image that they released, he had it was a weird angle or something like that. I don't know if it was overly photoshopped or it was the angle, but his jaw looked weird.
It's sort of like a god angle where, like, he's, like, looking, like, above you. Like, it was, like, a lower angle. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it looked like his, like, jaw was, like, twisted.
Yeah. Like, he was, like,
that was weird.
Chewing tobacco or something.
But, like, some of the set photos I've seen are a little bit better.
Yeah.
Looks more like Superman.
And he's definitely not as big as Henry Cavill.
Holy crap, no. Definitely
he's
not.
He's kind of a scrawny-looking Superman, but I would say he looks better than Dean Cain.
That's true.
The materials look a little bit cheap, but I think overall the costume design, especially the cape shoulder area, how the cape connects to the costume.
I hate that.
You hate that?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought that was interesting.
It's like a gold, like, plate, or, like...
Yeah, there's, like, a little gold band there.
Yeah, no.
At least they didn't use the red underwear again.
That's good. I guess if they're not going to use the red underwear, they have to differentiate it from Henry Cavill's in some way.
Yeah.
I guess, why not put red or gold? Like, what is it, a belt buckle?
I still wonder how they're going to use Superman in the show.
I think I mentioned this before.
Yeah, you can't have him, like, in the whole season. Otherwise, the show becomes Superman and Supergirl. So he's got to have just, you know, more like a guest spot kind of pop in and out from time to time. I'll be surprised if he's more than a couple episodes this season.
Yeah, this whole thing is really interesting to me. And I still haven't seen Supergirl. And I just realized, crap, that they actually started showing those episodes on CW starting, I think it was August 1st.
Yeah, so you
got. I haven't been watching them.
Come on, man.
I suck.
What kind of DC fan are
you? And I've been eager to watch it. I need to watch that before I watch Jessica Jones. But I know, I think this was confirmed, that the events of Flashpoint on the Flash TV show are going to affect Supergirl and have her, that's what sort of, like, gets her to transfer from her universe into the Arrowverse.
Okay.
Because the Flash made a guest appearance in the Supergirl season 1, and it was established that she's in a different, like...
reality.
Different universe within the multiverse. Mm-hmm. So
Is it just her making the jump into the Arrowverse, or is it her universe making the jump into the Arrowverse?
Exactly. That's what I'm wondering.
Because if that's the case, that means that Superman would live in the same universe
as Green Arrow and stuff like that. Flash. My guess is that she's going to be the only character to make the jump. And now, like, there's doppelgangers and stuff like that, so you could probably keep a majority of the cast. I don't think Superman is going to make the jump, because then you'd have characters like Arrow talking about him, Flash talking about Superman and stuff like that. So that kind of sucks.
Don't they talk about Batman already in the Arrowverse?
No.
No?
No, they don't. Interesting. They've mentioned Oracle once.
Not even Black Canary make any mention of Batman?
No.
Interesting.
No one mentions Batman.
Weird.
They mention, like, Gotham City and Coast City. Actually, you know, I don't think they've ever mentioned Gotham. Have they? Gosh, they mentioned Bloodhaven. That's what they mentioned.
Oh, okay. Where Nightwing
operates. But anyway, yeah. If they're going to get rid of Superman once Kara, Supergirl, makes the jump into the Arrowverse, that's going to be weird.
See, that's why I don't think that's what will happen. I think the whole universe will make the jump into the Arrowverse.
But then why isn't...
Or they'll merge.
Why isn't Green Arrow and Flash talking about Superman?
Maybe they will this upcoming season.
That would be cool. I'll watch for that.
Yeah.
I'll watch to see that. There for sure.
There you go. All right. I think that's all the news. All right. So let's get into what everybody has been listening for.
Yeah.
The Suicide Squad. Our opinions. Yeah. No.
We didn't do a song last time, I don't think.
What do you mean?
A review jingle.
Oh.
So you're going to do it? No, we're not going to do it. That's what I'm saying.
Aww.
Oh, you know what we didn't do? We didn't do the Battlecast jingle for the last Battlecast. That's what I'm thinking of.
Yeah, we did.
No, we didn't.
Well, we did the intro, the transition thing.
Yeah, we didn't do that. Anyway, it's your turn to do a review jingle. I'm pretty confident that it is.
Okay, all right, I got this. Ready?
All right.
What if I wanted to beg for the rest of my life?
Oh, gosh.
What would you do? Come break me down. Wiki, wiki, wiki. Suicide Squad, it's the Wild Wild West. That's all I got.
I think we've already done that on a previous
episode. I know, I'm bringing it back.
All right, yeah. I'm bringing it back. That works. Suicide Squad.
For those who didn't know, that was a mashup between Jared Leto's 30 Seconds to Mars, The Kill song, and Will Smith's Wild Wild West.
Oh, no, we got it. We just didn't like it.
Just making sure. All right.
Okay.
We got it. We just hated it. All right.
Where even begin? Okay, Suicide Squad.
So, I guess, do you have any experience reading any Suicide Squad comics? What's your familiarity, I guess, prior to this movie with the characters?
I know I've read comics with pretty much, like, all of the characters, from, like, Enchantress to Deadshot to Captain Boomerang. I know the reputation of the Suicide Squad. I don't think I've ever read, like, any actual comics, though. Like, not even New 52. But, again, I know the stories. If you want, like, a good, like, if you want a better version of the Suicide Squad movie, watch, what was the name of it? It was a Batman cartoon. Assault on Arkham. Batman Assault on Arkham. That was the name of it. But it wasn't really like a... I mean, Batman was in it, mm-hmm. but it was a Suicide Squad story.
Really?
Yeah, and so that's really cool. I don't want to spoil that for you. You should definitely go check it out if you're more interested in learning more about these characters and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So
overall... What would you say are your overall thoughts on the movie?
That's tricky. Okay, so when I walked... Let me start off by saying I don't think it was a good movie. I walked out of the theater.
I think it was a good movie. I don't think it was a great movie.
I don't think it was a good movie, but I don't think it was a terrible film either. Because there were definitely enjoyable parts to it.
I enjoyed this movie as much as I enjoyed X-Men Apocalypse, I think. I think it had some great comic book moments.
Mm-hmm.
But as a film, as a story, I don't think it was all what it could have been. I think of, like, the perfect version of what a Suicide Squad movie could be, when I first heard that they were making this film, and not being a huge Suicide Squad reader myself, I was thinking Reservoir Dogs. I was like, okay, so we got a film where we got these bad guys coming together, and you know, the story tells their individual backstories and flashbacks and stuff like that, and, you know, I just kept going back to Reservoir Dogs. Reservoir Dogs is a great film, and I think this film could have been closer to that. It's what I wanted. It's what I thought it would be. And in the end, we got something like X-Men Apocalypse, just a little bit more generic.
Yeah, I think this is another case for me where it just didn't meet my expectations. And the thing is, like, I know a lot of people who liked the film, like, liked it a lot, liked it more than BVS. Like, everyone I saw the film with said they liked it more than Batman v Superman. I was like, what? What?
I don't think it was as good as Batman v Superman.
But, I mean, like, even our dad, like, liked Suicide Squad. And he did. Yeah. He liked it more than... And our dad doesn't like anything. He falls asleep during movies.
And I can see that. See, I will say it's not as good of a film as Batman v Superman. I think Batman v Superman, the film, was closer. Especially... I can't even think about the theatrical cut anymore. Especially the ultimate edition of Batman vs. Superman was closer to what the film should have been and what it could have been than Suicide Squad. The reason I think people like Suicide Squad more is because it is a more enjoyable film. It's more fun than Batman vs. Superman. Yeah. I mean, like, a film doesn't have to be fun to be good. I think Batman vs. Superman was a case of that. Batman vs. Superman was certainly not fun.
But it was good.
But it was good.
Suicide Squad
and was and I'm talking about the Ultimate Edition.
Yeah, the Ultimate Edition. Suicide Squad was fun.
Suicide Squad was fun.
But not good, I don't think.
The story wasn't that good.
The plotting and the editing and the story, there were parts of it that I was just didn't make sense to me. And I don't know if it's just because, like, I have a familiarity with these characters and I know what they could be, that those expectations, like, just were not met. And other people who don't have those expectations came away liking the film.
Yeah.
I think I think comic fans, they keep saying, like, this was a film for the fans.
I don't like that.
They met
because
that.
I think, well, and I'm not a DC fan, but I think if I were a DC fan, if it were made for me, I think what I would want as a DC fan is for my DC movies to be more cerebral, and good quality films, as opposed, like, just to differentiate themselves from the Marvel style,
which is more like popcorn,
which is a little bit
blockbuster.
More, yeah, exactly.
And honestly, that's what I like as well. And I think that's what Ayer's original vision was. But if you, like, follow what's going on behind the scenes, apparently, if you don't know this already, there were two cuts of the film because so you'll notice that, like, the very first trailer that they released, or teaser for Suicide Squad, was very different in tone from when they did the Bohemian Rhapsody version. So, like, one was, like, sort of dark, and even, like, the graphics. The original one was, like, very black and, like, red and silver. Mm-hmm. And then when they did the bright pink, bright, you know, blue and green, and, like, really cool. This hasn't been confirmed, but, like, this is just sort of, like, behind the scenes, like piecing together and speculation and stuff like that, and some, like, leaks from inside sources. But apparently there were two cuts of the film. One of them was done by David Ayer, and another was done, I guess Warner Brothers hired Trailer Park. They're the studio that cut the Bohemian Rhapsody trailer, which was really fun and funny, to do another cut. And then they test screened those, and, well, wouldn't you know it, people said that the Trailer Park one was more fun.
Yeah.
So, because Warner Brothers was nervous that they were marketing a fun film that wasn't going to end up being fun. So I think Ayer's original version was to make something more cerebral, something more relevant, just based on some, like, deleted scenes that we saw in the promotional, like, trailers and stuff like that. But there was, like, a list of scenes that were cut from the film. And actually, I wanted to go over those. Maybe I should just go over those now.
Well, why don't we wait until after the review?
Okay, yeah, we'll wait until after the review. Anyway, I think just listening to those scenes, this film is going to be way more cerebral and I think better. And it's kind of upsetting to hear another case where, you know, like with the theatrical version versus the Ultimate Edition for BVS, Warner Brothers is fucking with the director's vision.
Yeah.
Yes. Stop doing that.
The Ultimate Edition, I will have to say, is by far the better version of the Batman vs. Superman film. It's frustrating, I think, to see that this, it may have happened again.
Yeah.
That studio interference.
And it's like, and it has nothing to do with David Ayer. It's not David Ayer's fault in a way, because the studio was nervous about, based on the reaction of BVS, they're almost like punishing David Ayer for something he didn't do, you know? It's like, we need to take control of your version because this other film didn't perform as expected. But don't do that. Let David Ayer, who's a good filmmaker, give us his vision.
And another thing, it all comes down to how you market a film. I think we need to, well, not we, but the trend of creating trailers that are somewhat disingenuous to the final product, that they don't accurately represent what the film is or is going to be, needs to stop.
Yeah.
I think trailers should not be misleading. They should be honest to the film. Yeah. I think.
And you know, there's a lot of controversy around Suicide Squad. You know, I think some of the fan reactions are kind of stupid in that, like, they're trying to petition Rotten Tomatoes to get shut down because of they say that the critics are mean to DC films. And it's like, understand what Rotten Tomatoes is before you do something like that. But another thing I heard that's semi-controversial, or just straight-up controversial, was that a fan is, like, taking legal action against Warner Brothers because for false advertising. And I also think that's ridiculous, but I get where the guy is coming from.
Yeah, that, you know, that reminds me of, I think that happened for the movie Drive. I heard a story about that where they marketed Drive as kind of like a Fast and Furious type thing. And if you've seen the movie Drive,
it's not.
With Ryan Gosling, it's not. It's not that at all. And I guess there's a similar case that happened here. They had a trailer and they tried to fit the movie into the trailer. And I think watching the film, you can kind of feel how they went wrong there.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah, the horrible thing for this for me is that David Ayer agreed to this. You know, he agreed to, like, hey, let's show two different versions of the film. He was confident in his, you know, let's put out something that people will love, and I'll be okay with that. If we have to edit my film to be more like these trailer park guys, then that's okay. And he's, you know, he's defending this cut of the film, and it kind of seems like I get this vibe that just from, like, his tweets and stuff like that, that they may not release, like, his version of the film, which sucks. Because, I mean, if they pulled a BVS and released an Ultimate Edition, that would be cool.
I think it would be, yeah. I mean, actually, honestly, I don't want them to continue to do this, but I want to see, I think this movie deserves an R-rated Ultimate Edition more than Batman vs. Superman did.
For sure. Absolutely. when your main characters are villains and stuff like that, absolutely.
Yeah.
Fits the bill.
Yeah.
But my biggest fear is that we're not going to get that.
It's likely that we won't.
Yeah.
From what we've heard.
Yeah.
So, are you okay with that? I mean, like,
no, I'm definitely not okay with that.
I mean, like, I guess, what were your expectations going into this film?
Okay, I guess I could let me break it down by character, because this is very much a character film.
Yeah.
My expectations, let's start with Deadshot, I guess, since Will Smith was pretty much the main character of the film.
Mm-hmm.
For me, I didn't have, like, any problems with Deadshot.
He was the best part of the movie.
He was for sure the best. That scene with Batman, oh my gosh.
That was fantastic. Like, I saw that, and you know, I'm not a DC guy, but I saw that, and I was like, oh! When I saw Batman, like, in the alley.
Yeah.
That's what you want to see. You want to see Batman in an alley fighting crime.
Yeah.
And the fact that it was, you know, with Will Smith, and, you know, we get that Ben Affleck, Will Smith, Jersey Girl reunion. That's awesome.
Well, Batman takes out handcuffs. He doesn't, like, all the fans complaining that Batman is, like, killing guys straight up in BVS. He pulls out the handcuffs this time. He wrestling. It was just a total Batman moment.
Ben Affleck is the comic book version of Batman.
Exactly. It was such a good shot. So cool.
Yeah, it was a good scene.
And then, like, even later on, you know, you see Deadshot's more of his backstory, and you see him, like, on the job, and you see him just pull out this badass assassination.
Yeah, the ricochet shot.
Yeah, the ricochet shot.
Yeah.
It's like, that was cool.
It was a great scene. Like, I haven't enjoyed a Will Smith performance like this in a long time. This, like, he's done a lot of, like, really kind of depressing films, well, honestly.
He's been trying to, like, go for the Oscar, but this is, like, Will Smith being Will Smith.
Yeah, and it's fantastic.
It's great. It reminds you of why you love Will Smith.
Right. Yeah. And I have to say, the funniest part of the movie, I'm going to jump to the end real quick, was the scene in the apartment where he's visiting his daughter or something.
Uh-huh.
And then he has to leave. He's like, What was the line? Something like, I can't remember what the specific line was, but I laughed my ass off at it, where he's like, I gotta leave, I can't kill all these people, or something like that. If you've seen the film, you know what the line was. You probably laughed at it. It was fantastic. I think he was great in this role.
I think the funniest line was actually when he was like showcasing his talents for Rick Flag and Amanda Waller, and he's telling, going through all the things that he wants for his cooperation, and he's like saying, like, and if my daughter, like, she needs to go to this like Ivy League school, and if she doesn't do well enough, then y'all need to white people that shit. I was cracking up. It was a funny film. There was really funny parts to it.
Yeah.
Especially for Will Smith.
Yes.
So
he was the standout by far.
Yeah, for sure. I think they did Deadshot pretty much perfectly.
I'd like to see him with his mask more, but other than that.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't even mind that too much. That would be cool.
I think his big action scene, because he definitely had the biggest action scene in the movie. And actually, I have to say, overall, the action was a little underwhelming for this film. But that scene where he was jumping on the car and just mowing them all down, that was the best action scene of the
movie.
Doing
what the military guys couldn't do. Yeah.
I would have liked to have seen him wear his mask there, but it was still a good action scene.
True.
Because he just feels more like Deadshot when he wears it, I think.
Yeah, and then I really feel like the marketing did him justice as well. Because like there was like one scene like where he's like, let's go save the world, that wasn't in the movie.
Mm-hmm.
But like other than that, like everything that was pretty much promised in the trailer, we got.
Right.
For Deadshot.
Him. Yeah. Definitely.
So, yay.
And for Harley Quinn, I would say.
Okay, no? I would disagree with Harley Quinn.
Okay.
That, to me... I really liked Margot Robbie's Harley Quinn, but it could have been better, man.
Really? Because I thought that was about as good of a movie portrayal as we're likely to get for that character.
No. I mean, I liked her Harley Quinn. Honestly, I would love to see just a film with Jared Leto's Joker and Margot Robbie's Harley Quinn. Just like sort of the origin of Harley Quinn. Because that is such an interesting story that we didn't get at all.
Well, I remember seeing some. They cut out a lot of their stuff
because it's such an interesting story. I mean, so we didn't understand why Dr. Harleen Quinzel, this bright, intelligent woman, would succumb to the Joker's sort of like mind trap.
Right.
We didn't get that. Like all we saw was him ask for machine guns.
Yeah.
But it's like we didn't even see, like, her reaction to that.
Yeah, we didn't see why she fell in love with him.
That's what I wanted to see. That's what I wanted for that character. I want people to understand who Harley Quinn is. And that's a big part. The way she fell for the Joker, it's like Stockholm Syndrome. It's like a tragedy.
Yeah.
It's so tragic.
The way he manipulated her.
Yeah.
And in the comics, the relationship between Harley Quinn and Joker is much more abusive. Emotionally and even physically.
He used her. Okay, yeah, and he used his psychiatrist to get out of Arkham.
Yeah.
That's the whole, like, story behind that.
Right.
And after that, like, he only pays attention to her when he needs her.
Right.
He uses her. It's not
a healthy relationship.
He doesn't love
her.
No. He loves Batman. And she loves him. So it's sort of like this... It's not a love triangle, because Batman doesn't love either of them. But, I mean... Batman cares for Harley. He understands the tragedy of that is Harley Quinn.
Uh-huh.
We didn't get that tragedy.
No.
And I think that was a disservice to the character.
That's true.
We got like the barest hints of it, but even then I felt like we saw more from in the trailer maybe of her.
I saw some behind the scenes footage. It was like some it was during the movie's production, and it was a scene where like Joker like slaps her or something like that. Like she holds a gun to him and he slaps her.
Yeah, like he's like escaping Arkham and like she follows him on a motorcycle. This is one of the purported deleted scenes.
Uh-huh.
She follows him on a motorcycle and she like holds a gun to his head.
Mm-hmm.
But like he charms her into like letting go of the gun and then he slaps her. So like you get that abusive relationship kind of dynamic.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that I guess they go to the Ace Chemical place.
Yeah.
Which for me, again, they also dropped the ball on that one. I mean, I could understand, you know, like, women power and stuff like that. It's her decision to follow the Joker, and she wasn't, like, pushed, which is what happened in the comic. The Joker is the one who violently created Harley Quinn. It wasn't her decision to become that. Mm-hmm. Again, adding to her tragedy.
Yeah.
And ultimately adding, the more tragic you make the initial story of Harley Quinn, the greater the redemption at the end.
Mm-hmm.
Because she is redeemed, because in the comics she does realize that the Joker is bad for her, and she kind of becomes, sets out on her own.
Mm-hmm.
And then in the film, another deleted scene was going to be at the end of the film, after they defeated Enchantress, they're leaving the station, and the Joker is there, and he, you know,
he confronts him, and he tries
to get her to come with him.
Uh-huh.
But earlier, like, he pushed her out of the helicopter. You know, in the theatrical cut, he pushed her out to save her.
Uh-huh.
But in the actual initial one, she's like, "Hey, let's go back for my friends," and he's like upset with her, and so he pushes her out.
Yeah.
Again, it adds to the abuse.
Yeah, see, that's the relationship I want to see. Not because I just don't like the idea of Joker and Harley Quinn having a romantic relationship, because that's not what I'm used to.
That's not what it is. That's contrary to the idea of the Joker. Now, I thought Jared Leto's Joker was great.
Uh-huh.
I thought it was so brief that you can't really compare it to like Heath Ledger or anything else. It was good. It wasn't not great.
Yeah.
At all.
So a lot of people are saying that they're he's in the film too little. Now, I ought to say, personally, my expectations were met as far as his screen time. I didn't think my assumption was that he wasn't going to play a huge part in the film. I thought he was going to be more of a background character, just kind of fucking things up,
mm-hmm.
which is kind of what he ended up doing. So I wasn't disappointed in the amount of screen time that he got. What about you?
I was kind of hoping he was going to be like the main villain, honestly.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh.
Just to go back to the end scene when he tells her to come with him and she says no.
The deleted scene.
She says no, I'm going to stay with my friends. He gets all pissed off and like drops a grenade, and you know, we'll never know what happens. I mean, it was shown in the trailers where he's like bye-bye and half his face is all like scarred and stuff, which is like callback to the comics, from the helicopter crash. But like, that's her redemptive arc, is that she rejects the Joker.
Uh-huh.
We don't get this in the film. We get the exact opposite.
Yeah.
Which I don't know if that's because they want to use those two characters in the upcoming Batman film together, and that's when she gets her redemption. I feel like Harley's redemption story is a big thing, and I don't want it in a Batman movie. I want it in sort of like her own movie.
Yeah.
Which is Suicide Squad.
Right.
To a degree.
Yeah.
So, yeah, in terms of the character Harley Quinn, disappointed. Good? She did good, but disappointed.
Yeah, she was done a disservice. I was referring more to the portrayal, to Margot Robbie's portrayal of the character.
I thought that was
pretty good.
Honestly, across the board, I'm going to say all the characters did a great job portraying their characters.
All
the actors did a great job portraying their characters. I mean, when you have stories about what on behind the scenes and how David Ayer prepped them, you better have gotten good performances. Because if you didn't, then that would just be really effed up stories. Did you hear any of those stories?
No.
So, he drove them hard to get into character. Sort of like the way Michael Mann sort of sets up his actors, like by making them like, you know, interview with people who like maybe the character's parents or stuff like that. And for Suicide Squad, David Ayer went to the pretty far extremes. He made his actors, he made them, like in the case of Killer Croc, like listen daily to like this real life Japanese cannibal eating human flesh. Just like these psychologically twisted stuff that he made the actors do. So if you didn't get good performances from that, then that would have been terrible. But we got good performances, so thank goodness David Ayer is not going to get slaughtered for, well, it was a
motorcycle,
sorry. So, yeah, thank goodness. Again, I'm just talking about the characters, so.
The actors?
No, I'm talking about the character. Again, actors across the board, A+.
Okay.
Amanda Waller, I guess, would be next for me, in terms of, like...
Going down the character list?
Yeah. Amanda Waller was another perfect one for me, I think. I thought they nailed her character. I thought, what is the actress's name? Viola Davis.
Yes.
Perfect Amanda Waller. Holy crap, was she perfect. She was like a better villain than Enchantress, I thought. She was just really effed up, and but really good, like in the best way possible.
I think she played a role really well. I think they did a good job of portraying her as this hugely kind of manipulative.
Absolutely. Just, that is Amanda Waller.
Genius, really.
Yeah, yeah. She's like Loki or something. It's just.
Did you think it was a good twist when it turns out that she was the one that she sent to them to rescue? I guess I said that weird.
Oh, they were rescuing her?
Yeah. I didn't see that twist coming.
I didn't either.
Except it wasn't like, I guess it wasn't an interesting twist.
I think it was definitely not as interesting as I thought. I was confused, actually. I thought they were going in to save Dr. June Moon.
Uh-huh.
But it was her.
I think it would have worked better as dramatic irony if, like, we knew ahead of time that she was setting them up to rescue her.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't know it, mm-hmm. so we knew where they were going and everything like that. Yeah. But I don't know. She killed her, I assume they're Argus employees, because they mentioned Argus in this film.
Yeah.
Which is like the DC version of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yeah. And she's way more effed up of a version of
Nick Fury. Yeah, Nick Fury's manipulative. Amanda Waller is
crazy, crazy.
She's kind of evil about it.
Kind of evil, yeah. But, like, you understand where she's coming from. Again, I think it was pretty twisted to see her, like, point blank shoot her employees in the head because they weren't supposed to know about Suicide Squad.
Do you think if Bruce Wayne knew that she did that, he would be protecting her? Because, you know, the mid-credit scene.
Yeah.
They make a deal where he protects her.
I don't know if he knows about that. They do hint that she knows. The end credit scene, that mid-credit scene was awesome. I loved that.
We'll talk about that later, though.
Okay. All right. Anyway, just another good Amanda Waller scene. That was probably my favorite scene, maybe. She had really good scenes.
Which scene?
The mid-credit scene with Amanda Waller.
Oh.
What was your favorite? Do you have a favorite scene?
My favorite Amanda Waller scene?
Yeah.
Probably the intro. I have to say, I think the first act of this film was my favorite part of the film.
Yeah.
It really dropped off. In the second act, which I think starts with as they go on their mission.
With helicopter crash?
Yeah, and then the third act, which I think starts when they leave the bar, I think it kind of all goes downhill. And those two acts kind of blend together for me. But the setup, I think, was fantastic.
Yeah.
The fact that it started off and she's kind of going through the dossiers of these different individuals.
Yeah.
And
did you like that scene?
The restaurant scene.
Yeah, did you like the whole, like, dossier kind of setup?
I did. Yeah, I have to say it was unique. I think it was well done. I don't think it was initially part of the script, but no, I like the way they did it. It, to me, that felt like how you set up a, you know, Reservoir Dogs style of supervillain film.
Yeah. Originally, I guess the film opened with Dr. June Moon, like, being, like, her possession. She's spelunking in the cave.
I have to say, it is disappointing that was the majority of character development that we got for some of those characters.
Yeah, honestly, yeah, that's true.
Like Captain Boomerang, the most interesting scene he was in was when he got captured by the Flash, I think.
I did not see that coming.
Yeah, that was awesome.
That was really cool. Miller.
But like, you know, characters like Killer Croc, you know, that was the most we saw of him. That he didn't really play a huge role for the rest of the movie. But yeah, I think that was my favorite Amanda Waller scene. And in fact, that was probably, you know, my favorite
scene of the movie.
Yeah.
I heard a lot of people complaining about the music of those scenes. That was like...
Yeah, I can see that.
That didn't happen for me. It didn't bother me at all.
It didn't bother me too much. The only one that did bother me was the Harley Quinn elevator scene. I forgot what song they were playing at that point. I can't remember the song, but I just remember it was annoying. I was like, this is all I can hear in this scene. Plus that whole scene in general was just weirdly tacked on. I think it felt like it was part of the reshoots or something. But yeah, like,
I agree.
Like, so like they're in the building and then all of a sudden she's like going up in this elevator and she's waving and she has this like own little fight moment or whatever.
Yeah.
And then she gets up to the top of the elevator. And they're already right there. Before they were like down at the first floor, they're like looking up and they're like, hey, where's she going? But somehow they got to the floor before she did.
That joke completely fell flat.
Was it a joke?
Well, where she's like, hey guys, and she walks out and, you know, her butt is jiggling and they're just like staring at her like.
Yeah, what the hell was that?
It worked in the trailer. It did not work in the film.
No, it just was so bizarre.
Yeah.
And there were a
there
few,
are a lot
there
of
were several
like
moments
that.
Like that.
Yeah, just the editing was
yeah.
Not
I want to say like the whole part where like there was a cool setup. They're walking, and you know, when they first get into what was the name of the city? Midway City.
Yeah, and like, which in the comics is supposed to be midway between Metropolis and Gotham.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but you can't. You know, that's one quick thing about Midway City.
Mm-hmm.
I thought the DC films so far have been like really good about remaining relevant or reminding people, you know, I know you hate this about Man of Steel, but showing like casualties of these superhero actions.
Mm-hmm.
This film had none of that.
Well, they evacuated a lot of it.
Yeah.
No, they had Enchantress's brother, I guess his name was Incubus.
Yeah.
He killed quite a few people
in
on
the subway.
Yeah.
That's true, I guess. I just felt like, I don't know. It was
you
definitely...
want to see people dying?
No, well...
You want to see consequences, I guess? I think it was perfect. I don't think you want to see too much more of that, because then it just gets depressing. You don't want to pull a Man of Steel on this.
I liked Man of Steel.
You don't want to start like evoking 9/11 in your superhero films. I think they did a good job of showing, you know, yeah, a lot of people died, but they got a lot of people out.
Yeah.
And so the civilians don't really play a factor in this
film. You know what really bothered me?
What?
Another tangent really quick. So this, apparently, like, by the time... They get the Suicide Squad, like, you know, bomb implanted and suited up and stuff like that. It was 3 days, right?
Mm-hmm.
So Amanda Waller was stuck there for 3 days. One of the biggest gripes I have with this film is that's not a Suicide Squad mission. That's not what Task Force X was made for. 3 days, you should have had Batman, Wonder Woman, The Flash. These are active superheroes.
Yeah.
Why were they not involved? This would have been all over the news. You don't send these guys in. This is a Justice League task. The Suicide Squad missions from the comics, from my understanding, are supposed to be covert.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and I guess this was, because no one was supposed to know that they went in there. But this...
She kept it covert because...
The
she,
conflict
like,
itself
it
was not
her
covert.
Fault.
But the... Yeah, they were going to rescue her. I guess.
She's the one that caused the whole thing. Well, because she lost control of the Enchantress and everything like that.
This should have been something that... A conflict that the world knows nothing about, in a way. That bothered me so much that you're established in this world with these other superheroes. Where the F was Batman? Where the F was the Flash?
Yeah.
They're
busy.
That's one of the biggest gripes I have with this film, honestly, is the mission was completely wrong for them.
Yeah.
Anyway, Amanda Waller. I guess we're done with her.
Yeah.
Good job. who's next?
Probably Rick Flagg. I think it was the next major character.
Yeah.
Or Diablo.
It was. I mean,
I never seen Joel Kinnaman give a bad performance. I think I like him as an actor.
He's a good actor.
Very straightforward.
I think he was one of the few to. Other than, like, the kind of... He didn't suffer too much, I think, from the edits. Because Rick Flagg is essentially generic, like, the generic soldier guy.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that's what his role is in the team. And that's what he fulfilled. So I'm not unhappy with it, really. I'm not thrilled with it either, like I was with Will Smith's Deadshot or Viola Davis's Amanda Waller. But mm-hmm. It was what it was.
What did you think of his... Does he have... In the comics, did he have a relationship with June Moon?
No.
Enchantress? No?
No, I don't believe he did.
So, okay, I want to figure out what happened in the scene where they were in the in his apartment or something like that, and she, like, sleep talks Enchantress. She says Enchantress in her sleep, and then, like, the witch, like, kind of gives him a vision, I guess, of June Moon dying or something like that. Was that a threat?
That's what I interpreted that as.
Yeah, okay. That's what, I wasn't quite sure if I got that right, though. So, basically, she was communicating to him that she
keep
will kill June
shut.
Moon
yeah.
while I go do this. So, really, this whole thing is his fault.
Well, I think it was a threat. Like, keep your mouth shut. Don't... Or, if you do anything, I'll kill her. I'm going to leave.
Yeah.
So, that's what I interpreted it as.
Yeah. And then the Enchantress kind of set up her plan and, you know, contacted her brother, I guess. Or she had an artifact that was able to pull her brother out of this random dude.
Yeah.
Now,
yeah.
So this is what I was thinking. One of the first thoughts I had leaving the film was that Common had a much smaller role than I thought he was going to have.
Yeah. Remember when I said he was like, his tattoos were going to be
people's
power?
Yeah, we said he was going to be Incubus. And I was like, yeah. They should have made him Incubus. Like, that would have been a much... Instead, we got this actor...
No-name actor kind of guy.
Yeah.
And he did... I guess he did fine.
He did fine.
He did... What, yeah. I don't know.
He was mostly CGI for the duration of the film.
It was interesting.
But size of role, I think, would have been good for Common, as opposed to the one that he got, which was like 45 seconds, and then he got killed. And it was just a weird scene.
A casualty. Yeah, so I didn't realize that... I didn't know it was Incubus until after I saw the film. I didn't know of the
character. Because they don't mention him by name.
Yeah, they don't. But, I mean, just, like, learning about him afterwards, I guess Incubus is Enchantress's brother slash, like... Yeah, I guess brother.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, in the comics, he's supposed to, like, mate with her in order to, like... Because she's, like, supposed to be, like, this host for their father to, like, come back, who's, what? Like, this major, like, demon guy.
Weird.
Anyway, that's more interesting than a friggin' machine to destroy.
Okay. So let's talk about Enchantress.
Okay, yeah.
What was her plan?
To create a machine that would hurt people? Or, like, to punish them for not worshipping them, or...
So, yeah, I couldn't tell. Does she want people to worship her, or does she want to kill people? What happened?
Who the hell knows? I don't know.
It was a weird plan.
It wasn't a machine. I mean, unless...
It looked machine-ish, I guess.
It looked like magic-ish.
It was like a magic machine.
It's not like she was, like, making a machine with, like, tools or anything. She was belly dancing and, like, you know, that was creating this swirling vortex of trash. Not a machine. But she did end up, like, zapping, like, creating, like, this, like, energy thing that was a satellite that she took control of. I forgot. I don't know.
Oh, see, I barely remember that.
Yes,
it didn't resonate with me.
Yeah, exactly. Like it was barely there. It was so.
It was barely a plan. Yeah.
I wish. She wasn't the villain, honestly, because like we had really no idea who the villain was leading up into the film, and yeah. I heard rumblings that she was going to be the villain. And I was kind of hoping she wasn't, and then she was. Yeah. And I was like,
that was kind of the thing. Like, I know in previous episodes, we were getting really excited by the fact that the trailer had not given away a lot of the story. We thought there were going to be a lot of surprises.
Yeah.
But, the plot was so thin that actually there were no surprises.
Very few. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, other than, like, the whole Amanda Waller saving herself kind of thing, but... regarding the Enchantress, I thought Cara Devandrine.
Devandrine?
Devandrine. He's way off.
or something like that.
I thought, there were some really cool scenes. The scene where they were in the White House Pentagon debriefing room or whatever. I mean, that scene was kind of spoiled in clips that released before the film. It's still, like, really cool, though. That transformation scene with, like, the other hand. Super creepy, super cool. We don't really get any of that later on.
No.
I mean, she, like, so in the previews and all the promotional material and stuff like that, we always see, like, dirty, scary Enchantress.
Yeah.
It turns out, like, a majority of the film, she's more like...
glowing, like, clean Enchantress.
Like, yeah. Like, a goddess kind of, like, Enchantress.
Yeah.
Which sucks.
Yeah.
She wasn't a big part of the... she was the main villain of the film, and yet we barely got any interaction with her. I don't know.
That's true. Well, you can say that for a lot of the characters. I think one of the big gripes, again, of the film is that you have all these characters who should be big parts of the film, but they really aren't given a lot to do.
There were too many characters. There were too many characters in the film.
Yeah, unnecessary characters. Like, you could have done without half of these characters because a lot of them didn't matter.
Yeah, so, like, okay, so we've gone through all the major characters.
Diablo mattered, though.
True. That's very true.
He had a good arc, I think.
Actually, did you know that Jay Hernandez, the guy who played him, didn't know the end of the film? He didn't know that he dies.
Really?
Yeah, he was like, well, I wanted to be in future films, but
he's possessed by a demon or something like that?
Yeah, that was interesting.
So he could always come back?
It was like a Mesoamerican fire god or something.
Is that how it is in the comics?
No, he's possessed by a demon in the comics, yeah.
But they made it like a Aztec kind of fire demon.
Or some kind of Mesoamerican kind of...
Yeah. To go with the...
It was interesting.
Ethnicity of the character.
Yeah, yeah.
I thought his story was good. Sad. It was killed sad. His family.
Yeah. But, I mean, there was a big contradiction in there, I feel like. So, in the trailers, you saw the shot of him, like, looking at a match and then blowing it out.
Mm-hmm.
That wasn't in the film. So, apparently, he feels really bad for killing his family, and he hasn't used his power since.
Uh-huh.
But one of the reshoots they added was him just to, like during the dossier scene, to show how, like, his power set, because you have to show that,
right,
is him taking out, like, a whole prison gang with his powers. It's like, no! He's upset by his powers.
Well, my assumption was that maybe that was, like, from a different time that he had gone to prison or something.
I didn't get that. Same. No? I thought it was the same during the same moment. But it's like, that ruins the idea of him being unwilling to use his powers later in the fucking film.
Yeah.
Come on!
Please. Okay, so the whole thing I found kind of weird about the whole Diablo story, and that the fact that he killed his kids, is when he talks about it in the bar, in the whole bar scene, there was a weird moment where Harley Quinn, she's like, you gotta own that, like, you know, own your evilness and stuff, like, yeah, you murdered your wife and kids, don't be sad about it, you gotta own it, you gotta own your, like, I assume she was saying own your badness, which is kind of what she's done. Yet, in her fantasy that she had when the Enchantress was showing everybody, like, their deepest desires or whatever, like, saying, I can give you what you want, her ultimate goal, I guess, or her fantasy. Dream, her desire, is to live a normal life. And, you know, the Joker was in her fantasy, and he looked normal. They weren't all creepy and everything, and they had kids. Yeah. And so, like, she's telling Pyro to own his badness.
Pyro?
And yet, Pyro. Diablo to own his badness, and yet she, deep down, wants to be normal. She doesn't. It seems like she doesn't want to be this bad person.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a weird moment. Own that shit! I was like,
There were some parts, now that you, the way that you said that just kind of reminds me, while I enjoyed Margot Robbie's portrayal as a character, she had a lot of weird moments like that where, I don't know, it would be hard for any actor to portray, but, like, she did a lot of weird things. Like, she called people pussy a lot in that film. I think she did, like, 3 times when she called people pussy. Like, when Will Smith put on his mask, she called him a pussy.
Yeah.
And I don't know, it was just, like,
I think
didn't sit well.
Well, and, again, back to the elevator scene, I think a lot of her, again, she did a good job with the role. I think the parts that didn't land were due to editing, mostly.
Yeah, I would agree with that. It seemed like that way.
Yeah.
I totally got that vibe.
Yeah. Otherwise, like, yeah, I mean, there's no other way to sell some of those lines.
Moving on to Captain Boomerang, I guess.
Captain Boomerang.
Pointless.
Gosh,
he didn't really throw any boomerangs. He threw, like, how many boomerangs?
He threw one. And how many times did they come back?
He threw one at Katana.
And it came back, and that's the only time it came back. That's his whole thing.
Did it come back?
Gosh,
he was more like knifey stab man. Knifey stabby man. Kind of. Well, there was a one part where he, like, and that was, I guess, his moment to shine. He threw a boomerang with a camera on it. But I was just thinking, how the fuck do you attach a camera to a boomerang? Wouldn't it be like spinning?
It's a GoPro. You just rubber band.
But it seemed like, so either he threw it really hard, and it was flying in a straight line, which boomerangs do not do. Or it was like a remote control boomerang, which kind of goes against his whole skill set.
Yeah.
I don't know what the hell happened, but he was, like, able to track it on his phone. I don't know what the heck was going on.
So, I mean, Captain Boomerang is supposed to be, like, the biggest shitbag on the team. And I got hints of that, but I also think he didn't pull his own weight, and he was kind of, like, useless. Which is disappointing, because if you were to ask me, like, who the Trinity of the Suicide Squad is, and again, mind you, like, my only real familiarity is, like, the Sultan Arkham cartoon, and, you know, like, I, you know, heard rumblings from, like, the New 52 and stuff. It would be Deadshot, Harley Quinn, and Captain Boomerang.
Mm-hmm.
They're, like, the three characters who, like, all the other members of the Suicide Squad are expendable, except the these
fodder.
Three.
Yeah.
Yeah. Most of the humor should have come from Captain Boomerang. And I have a feeling that, like, in original cuts, because originally he was supposed to be, like, way racist, way sexist, way just, like, more insulting overall. And just way more, like, manipulative in a way.
Uh-huh. More Trumpy.
Like, yeah, sure. Yeah, exactly. We didn't get that at all. And I still think, gosh, what's the actor's name? Why do I suck so much with names?
Jai Courtney.
Jai Courtney. I saw shades of great potential for the character there, but it just didn't deliver in this film.
Because it was probably cut.
Yeah, yeah, exactly, because it was cut. That being said, I loved a lot of Boomerang moments when he had those moments. Like the him with him, like the lighter, look, fire. I thought that was funny. That was
pretty funny.
When he, like, when they're like, you're free to go in the bar scene, he just, like, takes his two beers and runs away.
Yeah.
That was great. But again, that didn't pay off because it didn't explain why he came back. I would have been happy. I thought would have been cracking up if he never showed up the rest of the film. just runs off. That's like what that character would do.
There was a funny scene mentioned by the guys who do the Weekly Planet podcast, and he was talking about how he was expecting, because like with every Boomerang character, you have to have a moment where he throws the boomerang and, like, you know, it misses.
Yeah.
And the person says, "You missed." And then the other person was supposed to go, "Did I?" And then they get hit. But he was like, what they should have done in this movie, and it was Nick Mason who said this, he should have thrown it, and then the person should have been like, "You missed." And then he would have been like, "Did I?" And then, like, you hear, like, it splash into the pool or something like that, and he's like, "Fuck, I'm so drunk." Or something like that.
Aw, man.
Wouldn't that have been
hilarious? Yeah, he's, like, drunk the whole time. That'd be, yeah. So potential, so much potential wasted potential. Like, so many, this whole freaking film wasted potential. Captain Boomerang is like a great example of mm-hmm. that.
Yeah.
Anyway, one more can be said about that. I don't know.
Moving on to Killer Croc.
Well, it could be said about that.
Another version. There's so little to say about him because he was barely in the film. He was just like kind of in the. He was like just taking up space in the background for most of the film.
Yeah.
Didn't get to see anything really cool like him, like eat somebody.
Yeah,
like in a graphic way or anything.
Yeah, I remember reading this about this scene. I guess people saw it or filmed it like when they were shooting in, was it like Vancouver or Toronto? I forget. Mm-hmm. But like Killer Croc steps off the helicopter after it crashes and like barfs up like chunks of goat, and then like everyone's disgusted, and like he picks up the pieces of goat and puts it back in his mouth and eats it again, and everyone's even more disgusted. It's like those great.
That's a great moment.
Those great character moments. Why didn't you leave it in the film, you jerks?
Yeah, that's a good comedy. It's a good, fun moment.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Come on.
Yeah, and Killer Croc has always been... I've always had respect for him as a Batman villain. I thought he was one of the more interesting characters.
Yeah.
And he was... He had, like, two lines in the film. Totally underutilized. Totally unnecessary. He had his one moment to shine when he was, like... Where they had to place the bomb underwater.
Yeah.
And everything.
Yeah.
But, like, his action scene underwater was so muddled and kind of hard to make out what was happening that it was kind of wasted.
For sure. In the end, when they all, like, doing their part to defeat Enchantress, he, like, throws the bomb so Deadshot could shoot it. But, yeah, I don't know.
God, that was a weird scene.
I still think, like, he's one of the characters that, like, I would say don't cut him. Leave him in the film, but just give him more.
Give him more to do.
Yeah, yeah,
definitely.
And on a tangent real quick, the sewer scene. So, Scott...
Eastwood.
His character, I thought... I mean, not that Scott Eastwood is a big name, but I thought, like, this was going to be, like, a breakout role for him. I thought he was going to be, like, a much more important character. Honestly, I thought he was Steve Trevor's grandson. And that he was going to, like, sort of...
Be the new Steve Trevor.
Be the new Steve Trevor for Diana Prince... in the current timeline, because we know that the Wonder Woman film takes place during World War I, and Chris Pine cannot be in the current timeline. Anyway.
Carbonite.
I guess. He dies. He sacrifices himself, so there goes that theory.
Does he in the Wonder Woman film?
No.
Spoiler alert?
No.
Oh, okay.
It's Suicide Squad.
Oh.
Scott Eastwood.
Oh.
Detonates the bomb right underneath.
Steve Trevor.
No.
Okay.
Well, I was saying, I think this character is Steve Trevor's grandson, maybe also named Steve Trevor.
But it's...
No, he's... I think dead.
Yeah.
So, waste of an actor, I think.
I guess.
Well,
Common was wasted, too.
Yeah, Common was wasted. Ah, come on.
All right, moving on. Katana?
Katana.
Wasted.
Take her out of the film.
She does
not need to be in the film.
No.
Useless character.
Yeah, like, there was a shot in the trailer where you could, like, see her taking somebody's soul with her sword.
Yeah.
That wasn't in there either.
Not in there.
Not in the film.
Okay, and don't get me wrong. I really like the character of Katana. I think she's really cool.
The actress is good, too.
I'm talking about the character, not in the movie.
Yeah.
The comic character I'm talking about. In the film, get rid of her. She didn't need to be in this film.
Yeah.
Especially because if... you cut all, because apparently like all of Captain Boomerang's like racist and sexist comments were directed at Katana.
Mm-hmm.
Oh well. So since they cut that, they kind of cut their relationship, which kind of cut the need for her in a way, maybe, because that was like the big thing she did was like threaten Boomerang, Captain Boomerang,
kept him in line, kind of.
Yeah, and yeah, no, useless, scared of her.
Well, she also kind of dropped her sword, which left the way for Harley Quinn to open Enchantress to get her heart.
Which, I mean, that also kind of bothered me, because, like, Enchantress is sort of like this spirit kind of thing, and her sword kind of absorbs spirits. So I thought that was, like, I don't know. I don't know if it's good that it wasn't what I predicted or if it's bad, but I think that sword should have done more damage than it did.
Yeah.
It's the Soul Taker sword. I mean, that's a badass sword.
Yeah.
Anyway, who's next?
I think that's everyone.
I feel like we're missing someone. Slipknot.
Hey, there's no point in discussing Slipknot.
That was... I guess in the deleted scenes, he was also supposed to be, like, much more of a douche. Like, it's revealed that he's, like, a rapist and stuff like that. So, like... You really want this guy to die. But, like, in the film, when it happened, it totally fell flat. Totally. Like, you didn't see him in the dossier setup or anything. It's like they show him, like, get out of the truck, punch That's someone, and then, like...
Yeah, he came out of nowhere. They never went over his dossier. We never saw any of his, like, background.
You never saw him get the implant or anything like that. He comes out of the vehicle, like, suited up. Almost like he's like a Katana character. You didn't know he was, like, a prisoner.
Right.
And then they kill him right away. Dumb. Yeah. I mean, that part... Okay, he needed to be in the film exactly for that scene. But don't make it fall flat by not establishing the character.
Right.
And again, those scenes were cut. Because, gosh dang it. Yeah.
I didn't like how easily he was manipulated, I guess. Well, like, he's supposed to be easily manipulated. He's not the brightest crayon in the box.
Yeah.
But, like... I thought it would be much more interesting the way he kind of, the way Captain Boomerang manipulates him.
Yeah, I think that was
He didn't really get manipulated so much as just be an idiot, I guess.
I think that, there was definitely a disservice to the Captain Boomerang character. It should have been better done.
Yeah.
Like, Captain Boomerang should not have participated in the revolt, because really he's using Slipknot to find out if the bombs are really there.
Right. And you don't really get that.
You got the sense that Boomerang actually was trying to escape.
Yeah. Not just use...
Yeah.
To gain information.
Right.
Slipknot. So,
right.
I think that's all the characters. Two scenes I want to comment on real quick. The first one being right when they get into Midway City. I was going to mention this earlier, but I think we went off on a few tangents and didn't find our way back. So they get to Midway City and Deadshot is like, I'm going to take these guys out. And Harley Quinn was like, okay, I got your back and stuff. And that was kind of cool.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you could totally get the impression that Deadshot could and would do that.
Yeah.
And then they start fighting, and then all of a sudden, like, Rick Flag gets captured, and then Harley Quinn's like, big deal. No big loss or whatever. And then all of a sudden, like, Deadshot does a complete 180 and is like, oh, I gotta rescue this guy. Like, you know, obviously if he dies, we die. But, like, before that, he was so set already to kill.
Because Rick Flagg insulted his pride.
Yeah.
And Will Smith has to make the white man happy.
What?
I don't know.
I don't know. It was a weird 180 because, like, they were like, oh, yeah. Like, these guys,
not Will Smith.
Yeah, these guys are like, badasses. And then all of a sudden it was like, oh, no, like, they're playing the game. They're you know, they're working the system. Like, I feel like it would have been more true to character the way they were acting beforehand to just let him die or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
Anyway, the second...
Deadshot has always kind of been... I mean, he's a villain, but he's not, like, the worst of villains. He's an assassin, not, like, a murderer. Well, I guess he is a murderer.
But did you feel weird about that scene too?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, it was, sure. And I feel almost like it was an editing problem too. It kind of fell out of place. Was my wife laughing? What is she watching?
I don't know.
That was creepy. Okay, so the second scene, and I hate to kind of bash on this movie, but and we'll talk about more good things about the film after this. But
we should have started with that anyway. Yeah,
probably. The other weird moment that I had watching the film was right before the final blow, so Killer Croc throws the bomb into the machine, and then Deadshot is about to take the shot, and all of a sudden he has, like, a vision of his daughter. And the daughter's telling him, like, if you do this, we can't be together. Like don't... Like, was she telling him not to take the shot or something? It was, like, overly dramatical. It was a little bit cheesy. Like, with, the, like, the, all the rain pouring on him and stuff, and he's, like, having this horrible decision. Do I shoot or don't I? Obviously, you shoot. Obviously, blowing up the bomb.
She went to his mind. She was, like, trying to get him to not to shoot. It's her power. Like, they established earlier where she's, like, giving them their desires. She's trying to trick him.
That was Enchantress putting the vision in his head?
Yeah.
I did not get that, dude. I thought he was just having
She's trying to save herself and her machine and stuff
like
that.
I thought he was having a vision of his daughter, and for some reason the daughter was telling him not to shoot because that means that they can't be together anymore.
You know, she was playing to that angle. She was, like, trying to trick him.
Oh. Well, I feel stupid now because I bet you everybody else got that.
Yeah.
I was just sitting there. I was like, why is he all... I thought it was, like, maybe his guilt about his daughter coming back, but I'm stupid.
What did you think of the end fight scene?
Oh, good question. I thought it was about as good as the rest of the film, honestly. There wasn't great action. I thought it was it felt a lot like... I don't think you've seen the new Fantastic Four film, but it felt a lot like that, where it was very CGI heavy, a little bit unintelligible.
Well, I heard this this complaint about X-Men Apocalypse.
Yeah, it felt like the end fight to X-Men Apocalypse.
Yeah, like you see Apocalypse do all these badass things, like decapitate people with sand, but at the very end, it just comes down to, like, throwing punches and stuff like that and choking bitches.
Are you talking about Mystique?
Yeah. But this sort of seemed like the same kind of thing, where...
Yeah, she was super powerful, and yet she would rather team up with them and, you know, and try to appeal to them as opposed to just flat out kill them.
Or take out swords and try and take them out physically,
right,
and magically.
Yeah, that's right. There was the part where she turned back into, like, dirty Enchantress mode, and she started, flying, like, doing kung fu and stuff. That was...
Yeah.
It was weird. I don't know.
Yeah.
So I think that takes us to the end of the film.
Yeah.
Like I said, the scene with... Deadshot in the apartment. That was probably one of the best scenes in the movie for me. I thought that was so hilarious. The rescue of Harley Quinn by the Joker. I knew he was coming back. I thought he would actually come back before he did, just from what I saw in the previews again. But we already talked about that. But
I know a lot of people who you know, liked their relationship in the film. And I didn't hate it. I just know that it can be better and that it can be... Because it
can be more interesting.
It can be different. Yeah, it could definitely be more interesting. They're not supposed to love you. He's not supposed to love her. He would never rescue her.
Right.
Because he doesn't care about her. Because all he cares about is messing with Batman and Jim Gordon's life, you know?
Right.
It's very just... And again, I'm not saying that Leto's portrayal of the Joker was bad. It's just...
I liked it. I thought he was intense. Like, the scene where...
He was intense.
Where he's, like, he's in the club. Or was it the club? Yeah, it was the club where the prison guard went. And he calls him to the back. Oh, it was the casino. And then he walks in, and, like, he makes the prison guard, like, kiss his ring. And then he just kind of, like, stares at him. And then, like, he's, like, all of a sudden in his face
happy
and stuff like that.
Sits in his lap.
Yeah, I was like, wow, man, that's pretty intense. Like, but if I were that actor, I'd be like...
Oh, shit. For sure. Yeah, totally. It was definitely intense. Definitely scary. Like, I would not... If Jared Leto appeared as the Joker standing right next to me, I would be, like, pissing myself.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah. And you gotta feel bad for the actor, because, you know, he's really such a good... Everything I've seen him in, he's been so good. And
he's an Oscar winner.
He's an Oscar winner, and he really puts a lot into his performances. And, you know, he'll... Requiem for a Dream, I just keep thinking back to that.
Yeah.
He's such a good actor. It's going to be disappointing that he put in so much more effort than what is shown, and I hope they gave him his due.
You know, he got paid for this. I'm sure he did. He's an Oscar winner. He better have gotten paid for this.
Yeah.
But, and also, like, even that scene you're talking about, they marketed that, I can't wait to show you my toys, where he's like,
That was not in there.
That was not in the film. I feel like they cut right before it. Why not include that? Why not, like, they kind of dropped the whole ball on the Ike Barinholtz character.
Yeah, they never follow through with that.
They never follow because like he gives her the phone and she says, laughs. "Hey, this is from the Joker." She laughs and threatens him. He's like, "What does that mean? What does that mean?" They never follow through on it.
Yeah,
damn it.
They could have at least included him in the final shot. Like, he's standing guard over her. Yeah. Joker comes in and then kills him and then rescues her.
Why not tie up that thread?
I don't know.
Gosh, why?
Yeah, so much wasted potential. That's the way I definitely feel about the film. Actually, the more we talk about it, the more frustrated I get.
No, I walked out of the film super frustrated.
Yeah.
But again, everyone I went to go see it with really liked the film.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, let's talk about the good things.
Okay, and you know, the film was fun. It was funny. It had great moments. But I know too much. I know too much about
what it could have been.
What was purported to happen behind the scenes. I know too much about, like, the characters in general from the comics and how they could have been shown. Yeah. It could have been so much better for anyone who liked the film.
That's the way people talk to me about X-Men Origins Wolverine. Like, there are people who are like, why didn't you like this film? It was, you know, it was a good X-Men film. It wasn't bad. It was good. And I'm like, I know what it could have been. There was potential there. They didn't follow through. That's what this movie is. And, you know, in the end, like, I feel like with these DC films, there's so much pressure on DC and Warner Brothers and everything. And we all know, like, a billion things. You realize you got to have so much respect for the superhero films that are good and work, because a billion things have to come together for these movies to work. And in the end, like, this film only got, like, you know, 500 million of them right.
Yeah. I still think
it did get some things right, just not enough.
Yeah, and I think it's going to be successful box office-wise. Maybe not Guardians or anything, but I think the studio is going to be happy with the results. I think there will be a sequel.
To Suicide Squad?
Yeah.
Suicide Squad's a sequel?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I hope Black Manta is a part of it. If you're already going to establish him in the Aquaman movie, make him a part of the Suicide Squad, because he has been a part of the Suicide Squad.
Oh, that would be sweet.
Yeah. And just, I mean, the next time you do it right. Do it good. Do it in the way that fans know you could do it. I don't know what I'm trying to say, honestly. It's just, I'm frustrated.
Yeah. Get it down to one story. Like, before you shoot the film, come to a consensus between the people making the film and the people backing the film on what this exactly should be. Like, create like a mission statement for the film if you haven't already, and then stick to it.
I think you have that now with Geoff Johns.
Good.
You know, taking up the Kevin Feige role.
Yeah.
You have that now.
Good.
So,
good. Yeah, let him call the shots. Don't have this, you know, back and forth between the studio and the creatives and everything. I think that's the way to fix this.
Yeah.
So, overall, so what do you rate the film? Out of 5 stars.
Before I get to that, I said earlier in the podcast that we were going to go over some of the deleted
scenes.
Oh,
yeah.
Because I kind of want to get people who did like the film to understand why I'm disappointed with it.
Sure.
All right, so I'm just going to do a as quick as I can rundown of what was purportedly supposed to have been cut from the film.
Or was cut from the film.
Yeah. So in early cuts, the movie's opening detailed June Moon's possession by Enchantress in real time. So the reshoots reshuffled the scene to be later in the movie in flashback form, in favor of the new opening centered on Deadshot, which
I liked that opening.
Yeah, it wasn't bad.
Like I said, it was one of my favorite parts of the film. So,
Deadshot in the prison cell, watching the rain fall and thinking about his daughter. That was another shot.
That would have been a good character moment. Yeah.
El Diablo observing the flame of a lit match before putting it out due to his vow to no longer use his powers.
Those in the trailer.
Again, that's a conflict with what this movie established. That scene should have been in the film, and he shouldn't have been, like, waving his hands around using his powers.
Yeah.
Creating, like, flame constructs like Green Lantern or something. Yeah. You know?
Like words. And
El Diablo being escorted to a training center by being placed in a tube that fills with water to quell his flames, and then unceremoniously dropped onto the ground.
Yeah, that was in the trailer. I remember that.
That was in the trailer, yeah. And it was in the film, too, when he's when he rolls out. Yeah, that was in the film.
Oh, okay, yeah, that's right,
But, like, we didn't see the scene with him, like, in his prison cell with the mirror where he's looking at the match.
Oh, yeah.
So, like, in the film, it's, like, established, like, he's always in this water quenching or emitting
water-drenching thing. Yeah.
Which is kind of effed up.
Yeah.
Anyway, so the next one is, early interviews mentioned Captain Boomerang's racism and sexism, but the movie is light on examples of such behavior, which have apparently been deleted. Most of them were reportedly directed at Katana, to whom Boomerang is attracted to. So that's an interesting character dynamic. He's insulting to someone he's attracted to.
I think in the end it's okay to show a bad guy as a bad guy. I don't think...
Yeah, these are supposed to be bad guys. I mean, I'm against sexism and racism and everything like that, but that's this character.
Right.
So
by putting it in it doesn't mean that you agree with it. By putting it in the film doesn't mean you agree with it.
Right. So. You're supposed to hate this character. You're right. Supposed to hate this character. The character's supposed to be a major D-bag.
Yeah.
Then, you know, you could have, if you would have given Katana her comeuppance later in the film, I mean,
yeah,
that, you know, there you go. Justice served. So then, what's next? Early reports indicate more backstory for Killer Croc, revealing that he lived his entire life as a social outcast due to his physical deformities. He has a skin condition. That's his thing.
Yeah.
And has convinced himself that he is beautiful in his own way. Croc crossed paths with Batman while working as a muscle for hire for numerous Gotham's crime bosses while secretly planning to take over one day. We didn't get any of that.
He was a dummy in the back who said, hey, I'm beautiful.
No character. There were also scenes displaying his affinity for making sculptures out of discarded materials. Aside from jokes about Croc viewing himself as beautiful, only one of those were retained for the final cut. In the scene where he says, "I'm beautiful."
Dumb.
Yeah.
Dumb.
That I have no idea. Like, that actor... I feel like if any of the performances fell through as, like, being unmemorable, it's that one.
Yeah. I feel bad for the guy.
Yeah, totally. Deleted was a scene where Croc becomes sick. I already explained that one. Which would have been a great, funny gag scene.
Mm-hmm.
Early cuts reportedly indicated a passing reference to Slipknot being a serial rapist, likely to further paint him as unsympathetic to the audience ahead of his own death.
You already mentioned that one?
Yeah. More scenes of Rick Flag and June Moon's romantic relationship, including him reading the files of Suicide Squad recruits after Waller delivers them to him.
That's romantic. I remember the scene
from the trailer.
Where he's like, eats people.
Shoots people. You're possessed by a witch, and she's just crazy.
Yep.
Another scene where Flag...
I guess you didn't need that, though, since you have the dossier.
Yeah, the dossier scene negates that one.
Yeah.
There's another scene where Flag and Moon are out on a date. There's a... Extended scene of Joker interrogating Captain Griggs, including the line, "I cannot wait to show you my two new toys." So that one.
Yeah.
Some of these we've talked about already. Joker and his men escaping after shooting up a restaurant. Harley, who's already affiliated with the Joker, follows them on a motorcycle and intercepts their car. Joker bangs his head against the glass in frustration. So do you remember that scene where he's like,
yeah,
that's not in the film. Joker and Harley then get into a fight, which ends with Harley pointing a gun at Joker's head. Joker sweet talks Harley into lowering the gun, charming her, then backhands her across the face. Afterwards, we see he sweet-talks her again, and they kiss.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think you mentioned that one, too.
And that, I think of all the scenes that are in this list, would have been the one that I think would have been most crucial in making their relationship more interesting.
Yeah.
Extended Ace Chemical scene where Harley jumps into the chemicals... extended Batmobile chase scene with more interaction between Joker and Harley. Oh, we never talked
about that scene, the chase scene with Batman.
That was a cool scene.
Wasn't that cool? That was straight out of the comics.
That was, I jumped in my seat
when,
like, she was just, like, floating there, just, like, still. And then she tries to, like, cut him.
And then he punches her.
Boom, one punch.
But I like how, like, the Joker, like, wasn't there. Like, he left her for dead and everything.
See, that's
like,
the Joker. That's the Joker. That's the Joker. He totally would have done that.
That was a great scene.
That was a great scene. I liked that. I loved... The Batman scenes in this were great.
That might have been the best scene of the movie, I feel like.
That was
a Although great there scene. Was a weird... There was kind of a weird moment where it looked like he was kissing her romantically when he was giving her mouth-to-mouth.
Eh. Eh.
What, did you... Or was he just giving her mouth-to-mouth?
I didn't get that.
Okay.
He was just giving her mouth-to-mouth.
Okay.
Ben Affleck should be proud of his part in this film.
Yes.
No more sad Batman, please.
Sad Affleck.
Sad Affleck. Let's see. Harley using her baseball bat as a mock gun to shoot invisible foes, like when they first step up.
I could have done without that.
That'd been a funny moment. It was in the trailer. It was like in the music videos too and stuff like that. Extended scene of Joker breaking into the nanobomb manufacturer facility to arrange for Harley's neck bomb to be disabled. Actually, that was in the movie.
That was in the film, yeah.
I don't know. Okay. More interactions between Harley and Boomerang. Early cuts apparently included her really disliking him, despite growing affectionate to all the other members of the squad.
Yeah.
It would have been nice to have more relationships between
the characters.
Different characters.
Yeah.
Extended bar scene with Harley taking everyone's orders.
That's right, yeah.
Deadshot calls for a shot. Katana wants whiskey. Should have been sake, my opinion. blah, blah, blah.
It feels like somebody just watched all the trailers, noticed all the points in the film that were in the trailer that weren't in the film, and just kind of like made a list based on that.
Maybe, but I mean, these are pretty detailed.
Yeah.
As to what was cut, and like things like Killer Croc barfing up the goat wasn't in there.
But that there were set reports of that, of people seeing that.
True. They removed several scenes with the Joker to repaint his relationship with Harley as more loving rather than abusive.
Nice.
Joker and Harley get into an argument after he rescues her in the hijacked helicopter. In early cuts, he reportedly pushes her out to kill her. And then the helicopter gets shot down, but this was reworked.
I remember you already saying that,
And then the last one, Joker returns during the final battle in the subway station, face half-burnt from the helicopter crash.
Yeah.
And you know, we talked about that, so, yeah.
So, it makes me really want that extended cut. I know people will be annoyed.
Well, like, these
if we
like,
get an ultimate cut,
I will,
like we did
I won't
with...
give it to me.
Yeah, but...
I mean, I'm also be annoyed, but give it to me.
I'll
buy the shit out of that.
Right. Yeah. Just do it this time again.
Please.
And then promise never do it again. Just
please.
Give us the version that you would release as the ultimate cut and put that in theaters. That's what I want to see.
Please. Yeah.
Like, the Batman vs. Superman Ultimate Edition should have been in theaters. If you release an Ultimate Edition of Suicide Squad, that's the version that should have been in theaters.
For
sure. Put the Ultimate Edition of Wonder Woman in theaters and Justice League. Stop fucking it up.
No, none of these two different cuts of the film. Stop messing with messing with the director's vision.
Yeah,
I
agree.
Just because you get scared of one film because it's not fun, but it's good, you make this new film fun but not good. You can't stop being like swayed so much by public opinion. Warner Brothers is supposed to be the studio for creators' visions,
mm-hmm.
and
don't be
you
Fox.
Have failed twice.
Don't be Fox.
Don't be Fox. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, and again, I mean, you don't necessarily have to be Marvel either. I mean, that's sort of the route they're going with Geoff Johns.
Hmm.
And I feel like Kevin Feige, I mean, that's why Edgar Wright left, right? Is because he couldn't fulfill his vision. It wasn't Kevin Feige's vision of Ant-Man.
Right.
So, I mean, you could still, I mean, I love the fact that Warner Brothers is creative, like creator-focused. But they've done a disservice to the past two creators in not releasing their version of the film.
I think so.
Which I think is better.
Yeah.
Or, I don't know, I haven't seen this cut. I don't know if we'll get one, but I think just based on these deleted scenes, it would be better.
Yeah. So, what's your overall rating for the film?
I would agree that it's probably as good as X-Men Apocalypse. So, 3 out of 5.
I would say 3 out of 5 too. I don't think it deserves. I was thinking, but maybe 2.5 out of 5. But you know, there are a lot of people that enjoy this film, and they're not wrong.
Yeah, totally.
It is a fun film.
I would tell. I'm telling people. I mean, partly because I want the box office to be good, so they make more DC films. But no,
you're recommending it.
I'd recommend. I'm not ashamed to recommend it to people.
It's not horrible. It certainly doesn't live up to its potential. But it's not bad. It's you know, it's not a wasted time, I would say. If some people judge films based solely on how much fun they have at the theater, and if you're looking for an escape, definitely go see the film. If you are like Johnny DC and know too much and know the characters and are looking for something that's not there, then maybe skip it. But if you're listening to this review, you've seen it.
I hope you've seen the film.
Spoilers.
Spoiler alert at the very end.
We should have said that at the beginning. But We will put that in the description, episode description. So
we say that we never do.
Okay. I think that comes to the end of our review.
Yeah, I can't think of anything else.
Yeah, again, tell us, go ahead and send us your thoughts of the film. And reach out to us at by emailing us at dcmarvelbattlecast@gmail.com.
Or tweeting us at dcmarvelbattle.
Yep.
And follow us on Twitter, because we post a ton of news out there if you want to keep up to date on everything that's going on in the superhero film and comic book news world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Well, without further ado,
up, up, and away,
true believers.